Wow.
Yeah. But I made it. And That's then good. I went.
Did you get sober and then just stay sober, or did you relapse?
I stayed sober. I had I had 7 months without AA.
Right.
Nice. When I was living in New York, I was dating a guy who didn't really drink and was like sick of me, and so I got sober for him for about 7 months. And I went to one meeting, and I was like, "This is weird. I don't get it. I'll just." But I didn't go out. I didn't do anything. Right. I went to work and I went home. I stopped doing comedy. Wow. I stopped doing.
This was in San Francisco?
New York. I lived in New York for 7 years. And so I did try to get sober. But I wasn't, you know, I'd go to work and then I'd go home and just be like. And if I did go out, I was so petrified.
Must have been winter. Was it winter in New York?
It's always winter in New York.
It was winter.
Yeah, you don't stay out long in New York in winter.
I started drinking again in the springtime, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I was warm.
Yep, there you go.
I was warm and full of fear.
so we have four New Yorkers here, basically.
That's true.
Well, you don't really count because it was Ithaca.
Well, I lived in New York City, though.
Oh, okay, so that counts. Yeah. But I love when people say that they're from New York and you're like, where? They're like, Newburgh.
My first wife grew up in Manhattan. Does
well,
that
where
count?
Are they supposed to say?
Say you're from the outskirts of New York. New York State.
But nowhere else do you have to qualify that.
Right?
You don't have to be like Michigan State.
I don't know.
Colorado State.
Yeah. Nevada, you should.
You're in college.
Right. Right?
And there's nowhere to qualify with Nebraska. You're just screwed.
Unless you're, you know, college football. College football.
That's like telling someone you're an alcoholic.
Cornhuskers.
I guess, or you're all the way down at the end of the state by the river.
One of the worst movies that could have been funny was a movie called, and I can't remember the name of it. It was with John Travolta and that guy Aryeh Gross, where it was in like 88 or 89, where they got taken to a Nebraska town by the Russians to create like a regular town. Like, so, never mind.
Where do you watch these things?
I can't remember the name of
it. That's like beyond a Netflix account. That's like some sort of like.
I saw it. Right? You see some of the best movies.
That's
at
like
cable.
Some right wing. Like, you know, you've got to see what's going to happen. Yeah, that's like some serious.
Okay, so
serious
we are a show malicious. About addiction.
Are you a member of a militia?
I actually am. It's called the Julisha. Hey now,
holla!
Wow. Okay, this might be our last show. So in honor of our last show.
you know what's great about we have committed tonight to 13 more weeks.
I know we have. We're picked up for another 13 weeks.
And that's extremely exciting.
Yeah.
And that means we've done something right. Not much.
Yeah.
Congratulations. But,
thank you. Thank you. You're a kind soul.
Way to go.
Amber Tozer.
We're excited about it. Definitely.
And, the number here is 877-8830-830. 877-8830-830. You could also listen. Well, you could also find this at cleanradio.com.
Right. So before we went off on your tangential talk again.
Which was brought on by the guest.
Which brought on. Okay.
My fault.
Blame it on Amber.
I am blaming
so, Amber. So Amber, you were talking about how you went to AA and then you kind of scared you a little bit.
Pardon me.
Yeah, I went to one or two meetings and I didn't like it. It freaked me out. I didn't understand the steps and the God thing really. You know, I was like, I just won't drink. And then, I started drinking again.
Right.
And I couldn't stop drinking, and I did that for a few more years. And I moved to LA, drank here for a couple of years, and then my last drink was in the San Francisco night.
Wow.
On Judah Street, oddly enough. As she was on the Judah line.
Oh, boy.
Here we go. Go ahead.
Now, there's a Judah Street.
Amber's a professional comedian.
Yes.
Right?
Yes. I just play one.
Are you getting crickets?
Now he's on.
Now
he's on.
He's
on now.
Fantastic.
While the stuff is going across the radio, the engineer doesn't catch it.
Right?
Yeah, that's awesome.
So go on. So your last drink was in San Francisco.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was obviously after you got off the bridge.
Yeah, I made it over the bridge, went to a friend's house in Oakland and did coke, and then I woke up. I didn't do anything stupid. We were just talking, and I remember they all left. I was staying with just a few friends, and they left to walk a dog, and I was left in the apartment, and we had done a little bit of coke, and then I did the rest of it while they were out, and it wasn't mine.
Wow.
I supposedly hate coke, but I was like, "Oh, I'm just gonna do the rest of this because I don't feel good."
Great way to
good.
Make friends and influence
right.
people.
$1,000 later, yeah. You ran away from their apartment.
And And they were so dry. I don't know. I don't even know if they noticed that we were just all so messed up. And then, like, I passed out and woke up on an air mattress, and I was like, that's it. And I had to drive home that day. I drove to Los Angeles, so I was like a coke hangover driving from San Francisco to LA, and I just cried the entire time, and I was like, something is so wrong with me. And I just was like, I gave up, and then I went to AA the next day. Wow. Yeah. And I haven't had a drink since, so.
Nice. Well,
congratulations. Yeah.
Where's our engineer now with clapping?
He's actually answering a call. We have another call.
Yes, we do. Exciting.
Oh, we do? Mm.
Yes, just for you, Amber.
No, I doubt it.
Amber.
Well, it's not for Judah, I guarantee
it's definitely
that.
Not for me.
This is a hate call.
Please, no. Yes. I'm just curious, where did you go in New York that time? And I think it's something very interesting you talked about. I think a lot of people experience this, and it's something me and you, Andrew and I, discuss a lot, is God in AA. And it can sometimes frighten some people away. When I was 18 years old in Florida, I was in a rehab, and I remember they closed out the meeting with the Lord's Prayer. And I grew up in an extremely Jewish environment. I was not familiar with the Lord's Prayer. And I remember thinking to myself, oh, great, another club I don't belong in. And they're all saying it, and I'm sitting there, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. And it freaked me out. And to this day,
Hallowed be my name.
And it's actually Challah. Challah be my name. And but I don't.
You were included.
To this day, I don't. We actually lost the call. I don't say the Lord's Prayer, and I want to tell people out there. I think it's important that you don't have to say. Going to any 12-step group, you don't have to. You don't have to listen to everything that is said. You don't, you know, somebody says, hey, what's, you know, there's this common theme that, you know, never say no to an AA commitment, or never say no to a commitment, really sleep with me. And people always say no. And I say that as a joke, but there's this theme that I have to listen to everything you say. And I'm like, but it's not in the book.
I'm a supporter of AA.
And
yet there are some things that really concern me about it. And I think it's interesting, we have two women in, so this is a good time for me to bring this topic up. But it's been my experience from a lot of the women that I've spoken to that have attended a lot of AA meetings, especially when they're newcomers, that they get kind of preyed on by guys that have a lot of time. And, you know, they're getting hit on, and you know, everybody goes after them. And it's like at a very vulnerable time for them.
Just making sure Susie's not going like this.
Yeah. is that what it was?
Yeah, and if
you didn't get her name right, Judah.
Yeah. Yeah, very subtle approach.
And what do you think about that? Do you think that is that a kind of common experience, or have you seen that in AA? Or?
Well, I always go to AA meetings looking like this. So it's really, you guys, I'm super hot. I have like long hair and my makeup.
You're like that Freddie Prince movie.
But I there is like a meeting that I won't go to because there's like two guys that make me feel uncomfortable. It's like nonstop. Right. They call me and they ask me to dinner and they try to make it about AA, but it's not. Right. So I just, you know,
that's lame.
You know, it's like, let's talk about sobriety. But let's do it at this really nice Italian restaurant.
They're like, tell me your four-step, baby.
Yeah. So I felt a little uncomfortable at. But I honestly, I show up in my pajamas and I don't. And I.
You two in the pajamas. She's smoking crack in her pajamas. You're going to. There's a pajama
slumber party.
Was it hard for you?
What?
With being hit on or?
I think that most alcoholic women have father issues, so I was sort of basking in the attention of it.
Yeah.
I don't know that I can complain. I definitely was like cornered a lot, and then you feel weird going to that meeting. And then also something I am just kind of recently reflecting on, about 4 years ago I started going to the Rodeo meeting, which is a fancy schmancy meeting, and like, I'd say one out of every three guys would try to kiss me on the lips.
Wow.
Yeah, really annoying. So now when I go to that meeting, I always, you know, when I greet people, I'm like, hey. I have my head tilted back.
You put a fake herpes on your lip.
Fake herpes.
Isn't that weird? The most conservative meeting is the most lecherous.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. What do they do? Yeah, they're like, the Catholic Church. And then...
Yeah, they just go right in for it.
Wow. Oh, my God. That's
yeah, it's not cool.
But again, we're
but
not.
But then there's something about me that's exuding, you know, that kind of, like, availability, you know. So I, like, when I first moved to New York.
That's like blaming the victim.
Oh, I appreciate that. Thank you. But this is, you know, this is interesting. When I, the first year I moved to New York, every cab driver would ask me for my number.
Really?
And then after about a year, they stopped. But so I was obviously bleeding, you know, some kind of, like, vulnerability.
Yeah.
But that's part of what I'm talking about is that when people first get sober, they are vulnerable. They're looking for something. They're looking for an answer to this, you know, feeling of desperation and emptiness that they have, that they've been filling with drugs and alcohol. And they're going there to AA for support. And then if you're female, you know, and then there's all these guys hitting on you, that's not a very supportive environment, necessarily.
True, but, you know, it's a gray area because, you know, Chris Rock has a really funny joke about Anita Hill. Remember? Who hit
Clarence
on
Anita? Clarence Thomas.
Thank you, Clarence Thomas. And he was like, if Clarence Thomas looked like, well done, if Clarence Thomas looked like Denzel Washington, there would have been no issue. You know what I mean? So everyone's entitled to think you're attractive and make a move on you. You know, it's kind of... They don't know that you think they're hideous. So there's some, and then, you know, what if you are crazy about the guy? And then that's going to make your surprise.
We both knew somebody that was a little crazy.
What if you,
you know, who...
Write down some figures.
Yeah. But, again, I love the program of Alcoholics Anonymous to save my life. But there are flaws. There are flaws in every program, and it's okay to talk about it. And I think for years these things haven't, and that's one of the things we wanted to set out with the show, was to talk about problems that you... that arise as you're getting sober.
Right.
That it's okay to say out loud, hey, that makes me uncomfortable. Because we used to go to a meeting in New York where for a year we would all go out.
By the way, listeners, Judith just progressed to touching Susie on her shoulder.
I'm not complaining.
We would go to this meeting, and afterwards, a lot of people would go out to eat, and we'd go to the sidewalk cafe or a few different places.
So the wrist keeps coming like right by my breast.
Well, so you're
like,
sitting right close to me.
Yeah, it's very inadvertent.
All this
and I remember
Patrick's having the most fun. Our cameraman.
He's going to sell it to Skinamax after.
Right? He's like,
and,
he's like, you don't even have to pay me tonight. He's like, forget it. I'm good.
And he's like texting people. I got some great video. And blackmail. And so I used to go to this meeting, and I remember sitting there for, you know, we'd all go out to eat, whether it was Tiffany's, where there was a bunch of different places.
Oh, yeah. They had the challah bread.
And I'll never forget. You want to hear one of the greatest lines of all time? And
I don't know. Why don't we have another tangential
word
from Amber?
No, you might have been there. Amber, we were all sitting there.
I just sit here and wait.
I touched her again. And we were all sitting there, and this guy goes to me, will you invest in my meal?
Avi.
I didn't even have to say it.
I love Avi.
She was there that night. An AA guy said, to me, will you and I said, what's my return?
Minimal. Like,
right. Yeah. Minimal. And so I remember we used to go out to eat every night. And I remember after a year of doing this, a joke was said one night, and it was an anti-Semitic joke. And I remember looking at these guys.
I'm sorry.
I remember looking now, and it wasn't Susie. And I remember looking around, going, ugh, you know. And it served a purpose for a year. Right. And I said I paid my bill, and I got up, and I never hung out with those people again. And they're not symbolic of the what's important is the program of AA is the big book of Alcoholics Anonymous.
Right.
And that's that to me, that's the basic text. And if I hear other people's opinions or ideas, I say, is it in the basic text? Because if it's not, it's just your opinion. And I think it's very important because for me, it saved my life. I wouldn't be here tonight if it was at it, but it's okay to question. You know, it's okay to look at the program and say, is that working for me? If that's not.
Yeah,
no, but
like
that hasn't been the tradition of AA.
No, it's not. But again, we were talking about breaking the A in anonymity, and it's in a new era. It is. We're in an era where people are getting here younger because of the drugs out there are harder. You know, what are we supposed to do? One of the things that hopefully will separate Alcoholics Anonymous or any 12-step group from religion is that we change with the times.
Well, that's one of the things I like to